It's 4 p.m. in Singapore. We're live from DBS Asia Central. I'm Temur Beg, Chief Economist of DBS Group Research. Welcome to our year-ending 2022 event for the outlook for the coming year, as well as some stock-taking of how 2021 panned out. The way this presentation would work is I will talk first for about 20 minutes going over some of the key themes for the year. I'll use the screen over here to show you some slides, but not too much detail. The details will come in our flagship publication that came out earlier this week, and it's available on our DBS website, as well as in the invitation that you received for this live stream event. There's also a PowerPoint presentation, which is basically a collection of all these slides, which is also made available at the live stream site. Feel free to download that and look through it at your leisure. What I would like to do is just go through the slides right now, covering the main themes, after which I will have the pleasure of hosting three of our macro strategists. We will start with Eugene Leow, who looks at rates, followed by Philip Wee, who looks at FX, and then end with Chang Wei Liang, who will talk about the credit picture. And we will also pick up some of the questions that some of you have sent to us through the course of registering for this conference. So let's get going. So as I said earlier, that there's an accompanying publication. This is the cover of the publication. The title of the publication is Testing the Guardrails. We have put up a lot of guardrails in the last 2 years as we have dealt with the pandemic. We have medical solutions from vaccines to antiviral treatment. We have fiscal solutions from various support for businesses and individuals. We also have monetary solutions coming from exceptional amount of liquidity in the system and near zero interest rates around the world. All those guardrails are going to be tested in the course of 2022 as policies need to start normalizing, as fiscal support will be sort of forced to be withdrawn to some extent, and hopefully all these variants, all these viral infections will begin to fade and we'll see what we call a reopening trade. Much of that should have played out this year. Some of it got interrupted. 2022 ought to be a little clearer, hence the cover with the fairly bright moon, but faded by the clouds. We'll see which one wins, the cloud or the moon with this glory. All right. So if you read the publication or go through this PowerPoint presentation at your leisure, you will see that the key points that we want to take on head on are the inflation debate, the temporary versus permanent, the structural versus cyclical issue, and where that is taking us. And I will share with you some of the taste of our detailed analysis that's in the publication. Followed by that, we will of course talk about the elephant in the room, Fed tightening, how much of that is likely, what would be the spillover and the implications of that for the broader economy and financial markets. After that, we will talk a little bit about the pandemic. I really hope that I would not have to talk, but with the Omicron virus variant coming out, we still have to touch on that and its implication. We will then talk a little bit about the legacy of this crisis, the enormity of fiscal burden that have been taken on to deal with the crisis and what that means for growth and economies going forward. And then we will end with China credit distress issues and then a bit of an EM risk analysis that we have done in-house. And then I will dare to end with a constructive scenario that all the stuff that we worry about, all the risks that are out there, there's also a chance it just all might work out and 2022 could be a pretty nice year. So let's hope for the best, but first, take cognizance of the risks at hand. Now, this is a chart that shows to you our growth estimates for 2021 on one axis of the scatter plot and the 2022 forecast that we have. Even without squinting really hard and trying to discern which dot represents which country, bear this in mind. This 45-degree line that I have running through the middle of this chart basically tells you if you are on top of this chart, your 2021 growth would be a little higher than your coming year's growth, 2022. So you'll be slowing down a bit next year. If you're in the bottom part of the curve, below the 45-degree line, then next year is going to be characterized by a slight pickup in growth. So who's at the bottom part of this quadrant? Well, it would be a country like Vietnam, which suffered a lot, about 2% growth this year, having been a star performer in the early part of the COVID crisis, stumbled badly this year around resurging virus episodes. We're looking at Vietnam growing to close to 4% next year. Who else is there? Well, it'll be like, you know, China, Singapore, Hong Kong, who have all had, you know, pretty decent years, but might actually have a little more in store. I just realized we're talking about inflation right now. We'll talk to the growth story in a moment. Inflation, actually not that different of a story. Again, the same approach that the 2022 outcome would be a little better, higher, if you will, than the 2021 outcome. And in that case, we're talking about two key countries here that we need to focus on. First is the US, which, of course, everybody talks about the 4% inflation outcome for this year on average. Headline will end the year much higher than that, but the average for the year is 4. Even core PC inflation in the US would be over 4 by the end of the year. But average, we're talking about 4.5 this year and a little less next year, about 4. But when you look at the lower part of the screen, where countries with really low inflation this year, whether it is, you know, China or Hong Kong or Thailand, would all see inflation sort of bottom out and pick up a bit on the back of higher energy prices and so on. Then we have a few countries that are sort of in the middle of this picture: Eurozone, South Korea, Singapore, Hong Kong. Not exactly bastions of very high inflation. So this year, these economies were characterized by 2.5. They will be characterized by similar inflation outcome next year. That means you probably will not have tremendous pressure to normalize, but there'll still be some nudging, as we've seen in the case of Korea this year. We've seen in communication from a few other countries that they're not very worried about inflation per se, but rates are way too low, growth is picking up, and therefore they would still think that there is room for normalizing policy. But the key question here for me, as far as emerging markets is concerned, is India. 5% inflation this year, and probably going to be another 5% next year as the economy goes through its reopening dynamic. This will almost certainly prop the RBI into start normalizing policy, whether it is, you know, pushing up the reverse repo rate or go outright and start hiking repo rates. All of that is on the cards for India going into 2022. Now, the inflation issue and the risks around that are very well known. Most of you who are attending this call have been reading in the newspapers, whether it's a supply chain bottleneck or higher energy prices, some degree of dislocation in the price of electronics, again, because of supply chain issues, food prices being elevated from soybean to palm oil. All of that story is very well known. And I think some of that story will remain for 2022 as well. So inflation is not going away anytime soon. You will hear from Eugene later on that the Fed would have to start thinking hard about communicating its policy action so that it doesn't lose its credibility from the markets. But this is about now and a few months from now. What about the medium term? Are we on the cusp of a broad-based outbreak of inflation? And on that, we remain on the camp of a very strong no. Why is that the case? Why aren't we worried about inflation in the long run? Well, there are many things. Technology being the first and foremost of that. Over the last 2-3 decades, technology has acted as a major source of disinflationary impulse. The phone that you are watching this live stream with, or the iPad that you are using, the price of that has not gone up that much in inflation-adjusted terms. But the processing power, its capability, its quality is up by factors of hundreds over the last 10 years. Meaning, on a quality-adjusted terms, those prices have actually gone down substantially. Similarly, for car prices, although right now the big story is auto prices are going up, old car prices are going up, the fact of the matter is, in real terms, auto prices have not changed for decades, again, because of technological advancements, because of automation and supply side, and so on. These things are not going to disappear. You may have supply side dislocation today, tomorrow, and a few months from now, but for the long term, inflation remains a major source of disinflation. Similar in the supply side, right now, for example, in the US, shale producers are not very keen on expanding their capacity to produce because they have had major boom-bust cycles in the last few years. Their shareholders reward them for actually holding back supply as opposed to going out and putting out more rigs, but that's a very short-term phenomenon. If oil stays at $80, $90, at some point, 6 months, 9 months from now, shale producers will also come in. So that's one example of how the supply side, on an endogenous basis, starts responding to higher prices. And therefore, I again think that some of the supply side disruption that we see right now will be temporary. We will get more supply added, provided demand and prices remain high. Aging is a very major source of deflation for the medium term, whether it is China or the US or Europe. We are seeing, of course, Japan. We are seeing a large part of the world being characterized by this one-way street that will be marking civilization of the generations, if you will. And when you have, as a share of population, a shrinking labor force, chance of that society being a highly inflationary society is very low. People save more, people spend less, because, again, the elderly tend to have, you know, lower marginal propensity to consume simply because, you know, they don't have that much money to spend on. And as a result, aging is also a major determinant of inflationary dynamic, and that's not changing anytime for the medium term, another factor. Inflation expectations and debt trap are pretty important factors as well. Inflation expectations have been earned through the hard way. Major forceful policy action 40 years ago in the US to the ECB over the last 30 years, showing repeatedly that it always has been asymmetric in its fears of inflation versus accommodating low inflation. Even if you see the last 5-7 years dynamic of the ECB or the Fed being rates very close to zero, you have noticed whether it was a taper tantrum in 2013 or what is happening with the debate now. The moment inflation leaves the 2 to 3% range, there's a lot of consternation and the policymakers are forced to adjust. And as a result, inflation credibility remains intact. So I don't think that is being sacrificed even in this particular episode where we have temporary pickup in inflation. And finally, debt trap. And this is a very important one. You'll see in a chart very soon where I show that debt burdens have gone up substantially in the last 2-3 years because of the COVID-related expenditure. That means you cannot really afford higher interest rates. And if you cannot afford higher interest rates because inflation is picking up a little bit, the moment interest rates go up just a little bit, it will bring the economy down and it will lead to a debt deflation related mutually reinforcing cycle where higher inflation leads to higher interest rates and immediately leads to a contraction in growth and easing of price pressure. So that's the sort of world we probably are living in, characterized by good things like technology and supply side, but also bad things like aging dynamic and debt trap. Then finally, one important point that we need to keep in mind, which sort of runs counter to the view that I presented so far. This view presented so far is, worry about inflation in the short term, don't worry about the middle term, medium term, except for one fund. Typically, a major structural change around the world in recent centuries have been associated with deflation. The climate transition may not be one of them. To make proper climate transition, we probably would have to do what we call in economics a relative price adjustment. Price of fossil fuels have to go up substantially, and that would also probably switch demand toward renewables. But to do that, the transition may be inflationary. So that's one thing to keep in mind. May not be the biggest issue right now, but it'll be a recurring issue in the coming years. You probably have seen it play out already in the context of China this year, when China imposed strong coal production targets on regions, and then at one point you had major problems with respect to electricity production because those regions were running into quota limits. All right. So that's the whole inflation story. We will talk a little bit about it more when Eugene comes back to the floor. Now, this is a slide that I wanted to show you earlier, which I mistook for. But this is a growth story. And again, the 45-degree line tells you countries that have grown faster this year than they're likely to grow next year. And the bottom part of the story is about countries that were slow this year will grow faster next year. And just like I was showing you earlier, although that was the inflation picture, in the growth side, the big story would be Vietnam. Stumbled badly this year, going to accelerate substantially next year on the back of favorable base effect, reopening trade, and a very strong supply side response around exports. Similarly, for many ASEAN countries, whether it's Philippines, Malaysia, Indonesia, Thailand, stories are mixed. We are less excited about Thailand than we are about Philippines. Malaysia, Indonesia fall in the middle, but all of these countries stumbled repeatedly around COVID outbreak this year. We think 2020 will be a much better year for them. On the top of the screen, you've got the likes of India, China, Singapore, US. All of these countries saw base effect related, reopening related, big pickup in activity. They're all part of the global supply chain. They're all facing strong consumer demand from people who cannot travel, but they want to buy a lot of stuff. So they grew handsomely this year. They slow down a bit. But of course, it's all relative. In the case of India, 9% growth to be followed by 6.5%, nothing to scoff about. China, 8% growth followed by 5-ish. We have some question marks about China. We'll come to that later. And then we have the cases of like the US, Singapore, characterized by 6-7% growth this year, will be probably down to 3-3.5% next year, which are, for such advanced rich economies, still pretty strong numbers. Okay, let's talk a little bit about the pandemic. Right now, it's all about Omicron, but there are other things going on. Firstly, the efficacy of antiviral treatments. If indeed Omicron turns out to be extremely infectious but not particularly lethal, well, then it'll be a very good test of various antiviral pills that we have. People will get it, inevitably, given how infectious it is, but the treatments should make sure that people don't die from it or don't get very sick from it. So that's the big story for 2022. As various antiviral pills get approved, how effective they are, and can that really be the final chapter of this pandemic? Second issue is the efficacy of booster shots. I personally am not looking forward to a world where I have to take a booster shot every 6 months. That's a lot of shots. And from a cost perspective, from a logistics perspective, from people's expectation perspective, that's problematic. However, it seems like, especially the mRNA vaccines that we have taken in Singapore, the efficacy is ebbing within 6 months, 9 months or so, and therefore frequent booster shots may be needed. So let's hope and pray that it doesn't have to be every 6 months, because if it's 6 months, think about the cost and the logistics that are required. It really will get in the way of proper normalization of economies even 2-3 years from now. Then the issue of children's vaccination. As we all know, kids between 5 to 12 are on the cusp of getting vaccinated around the world. This would, of course, make a very big difference in terms of people's expectation, their confidence about being able to travel, to move around. Because right now, I myself have an 8-year-old child. I'm very reluctant to travel. Even if I'm vaccinated, my wife is vaccinated, we want to wait for the little guy to get vaccinated, right? Then there is the issue of global travel policy. Look at what has happened over the last 2 weeks. The second the Omicron virus-related issue came up, countries started shutting down and started becoming very, very focused on their own citizens, and that's about it. So that's a very big problem for global reopening trade to happen. As we speak, African country citizens are basically being shunned all over the world. They just can't travel, although it's very early days as far as the seriousness of the Omicron virus is concerned. Countries are shutting them down. Similarly, within country travel, in some cases, for countries which have very strong zero tolerance policy like China, they're shutting things down, and all sorts of, you know, stay home requirement, regular testing requirement, all those things are coming back. So that's another thing to keep an eye on. And then finally, just like Omicron has reminded us, this pandemic is by no means over. There will be other variants. As long as we have a level playing field in the world of everybody getting vaccinated, we will have variants moving through the system. So that's the biggest testament to the inequity of vaccine introduction around the world. The rich countries got vaccinated very quickly. The poor countries are lagging, and therefore the variants spread and created there, and which then becomes a problem for the rich countries. So we're not out of it till we take care of everybody else. That's the big lesson of this pandemic, and we're learning it the hard way. I said earlier that, you know, the fiscal issue is one that needs to remind us repeatedly that inflation cannot be out there for a very long time, because if it's out there for a very long time, there will be major monetary policy response, and it would immediately create serious debt deflation problems in most countries in the world, because the debt burden is so high that high interest rates will immediately cause major fiscal problems, major growth-related problems. Consider this chart. Again, you don't have to squint too much. It's a bunch of upward-sloping lines. All that's saying is that the countries in this chart, wherever they were with respect to debt-to-GDP ratio in 2019, they've now gone up to 2022 substantially more. So in the case of the US, from 108 to 130% of GDP. In the case of EU, from 84 going closer to 100% of GDP by the time next year is over. Even countries like Indonesia, which was never a country that I worried about as far as debt GDP is concerned, just this 3 years, we have almost a third increase, from 30% to almost 43.5% by 2022. Meaning, the cost is real. It's not just printing funny money, it's not quantitative easing, it is actual substantial debt burden on the population, on the taxpayers of all these countries. So the appetite and capacity to add more debt, to come up with more pump priming would be limited, and therefore growth would stumble substantially if indeed we see inflation growing up. That's the main issue. Some people would argue right now there's a huge demand side component to inflation. People want to spend money because they're getting higher wages. People want to spend money because they're getting more social safety net support. That's all well and good. But since some of those support measures have come through major increase in debt, you are going to have an issue with respect to the economies to absorb that debt. Additionally, there is, beyond the issue of domestic funding and external domestic finances, there's the issue of external finances. This is a rather complicated chart. I'm not going to explain it to a large extent, but the main point that we want to say in this chart is that in 2013, when the Fed was considering tapering asset purchases, the global economy went through a major convulsion. Emerging markets suffered a lot, particularly in our neighborhood. We saw Indonesia, Malaysia, India seeing major pressure on their exchange rates, major pressure on through capital outflows and so on. Would we see a similar thing as the Fed is now being more and more boisterous about asset purchase being cut back and entertaining rate hikes next year? Well, the short answer is yes. It's going to be a problem for emerging markets in general. But for Asia, there is some silver lining. What this chart is telling you, and I encourage you to read our piece, you'll understand in greater detail if you do, is that the gray bar being 2022 forecast of gross external funding with relation to reserve is that the buffers in Asia are by and large much bigger now than they were back in 2013. Therefore, we can absorb the shock that is coming to us in the form of higher dollar rate cost, in the form of some degree of capital flow volatility. So emerging markets will probably suffer, but non-Asia emerging market is probably the one that is really going to suffer. Within Asia, I'll keep an eye on Malaysia. At least in this analysis, it's showing that's the only country in Asia where the buffers haven't really changed between 2030 and now. But one helpful point for Malaysia is, of course, that high commodity prices is a good thing for its external balances. So let's see how 2022 pans out in relation to 2013 as far as Malaysia is concerned. But Indonesia and India, two other countries that really suffered last time, for them, the buffers are much, much bigger. They've added a lot to their reserves. The current account is not what it used to be. So buffers in place. Inflation is an issue in the near term, but hopefully not for the longer term. We may be entering the final chapter of this pandemic, but watch out for the variants. Those are the big takeaways from me on the economic side. What I want to do now is start talking about the broader asset market questions. But before I do that, I just want to leave you with one possible panacea. That all the risk factors that we talked about, and when Eugene comes on, we will talk about this even more, is that it may not have to be that bad. It may actually work out to some extent, because you could have four things play out next year. On each of them, they're not low probability events. If you put them all four together, maybe the probability is not 50%, but I still think that all four panning out is not that unlikely. Fading of the pandemic, easing of supply side bottlenecks, persistence of strong demand, and some degree of détente between China and the US. Mind you, all four things are not a wish list. They're actually playing out to some extent already. The Omicron-related panic notwithstanding, worldwide death, severe illness from the pandemic have been easing for many months, and we're beginning to see more and more treatment and more booster doses getting introduced, which ought to be good for dealing with the pandemic. On the supply side, just look at what's happening to Baltic dry freight rates. They were spiking through July, August, September, October. They've been coming down substantially on the back of China weakening. But on the demand side, particularly in the West, despite some degree of consternation about higher fuel prices, consumers remain buoyant. They're buying a lot. The Thanksgiving Christmas season in the US looks like very likely to be a blockbuster one. And then finally, on the China-US side, we saw a lot of tough rhetoric in the first half of this year. But now, if you hear from the US Trade Representative, when you hear from US Secretary of State, it doesn't seem that the US is as strident in pushing back on China the way the previous administration was. On the areas of climate change, on the areas of trade, perhaps even on the area of non-sensitive technology, there's a lot of meeting of the mind happening between the Chinese and the US. So yes, on issues related to geopolitics, on sensitive technology, these two are not going to be allies, but there's still a lot of room for working together. Let's hope 2022 would be more about working together as opposed to working against each other. With that in place, I want to start talking about the market strategy. Eugene Leow is with me. Eugene, welcome to the live stream.
Good to be here.
Great to have you. So your job is to look at fixed income strategy, both in the G3 space as well as the emerging markets. So we, of course, will spend quite a bit of time talking about the Fed, and you probably will start with that. But walk us through your main themes for 2022 that is coming up.
Right. So for me, I've been thinking, right, we've been going through the pandemic for close to 2 years now. And as you have mentioned, we got better ways to combat the virus. We got treatments, we got vaccines. We got all these things that allow us to deal with subsequent waves in a better fashion. So, and many countries, many economies are realizing that we have to go from pandemic, we have to exit the pandemic and go into an endemic situation where we learn to cope with the virus. It's going to stay with us, right? There'll be variants, more variants to come. And there could be occasional moments where we have to get to more stringent measures, but life goes on. Right, so as we exit the pandemic, I was thinking, the central banks too have to exit exceedingly loose monetary policy, right? So when the pandemic first hit in the early part of last year, the default strategy is to print copious amount of money, cut rates to zero, right, to make sure that the stresses don't go out of hand. But it has been almost 2 years. The recovery along much of the DM has been a lot stronger than what many policymakers have thought possible, even just 3, 4, 5, 6 months ago. So given where fundamentals are currently, it doesn't seem to make sense for that much money printing to continue, nor for interest rates to stay so low. There could be some deviation between where growth, inflation, and policy settings are, but where they are now is just a bit too far off. So the chart behind me, what I have over here, is one where I show what the Fed pricing, how many hikes there will be over the next 3 years, and where we are, that's the red line. Right? And where we were, that's the gray dotted line, and you realize that it's much, much lower around the middle of the year. Now, before the Omicron virus news hit, we were slightly higher at a solid gray line. So the takeaway is that even though the Omicron virus, when the news hit, it caused a lot of volatility in the markets, and for the rate space in the longer term yields, the front of the curve is very consistent, right? That the Fed has to start normalizing policy, right? It has to price in some rate hikes. We have to take back some of the rate cuts that was put in place last year. This story has to play out not just in the US, where we are watching very closely and where many policymakers are also taking cues from, but across the DM, that is happening. And that is the theme we expect to play out over the next few quarters, even as the Omicron variant is proving to be a little bit challenging. For the EM side, it's really more of a mixed picture, right? Some economies which are facing more inflation risks and where growth is becoming a bit more elevated and where external funding risk is more of a challenge, you've seen that rate hikes are kicking in, right? So for some of the economies, including Brazil, including Russia, rate hikes have already kicked in. Whereas in Asia, the more hawkish ones are Korea. But short of that, I think most of the other economies are looking to normalize policy sort of in tandem with the Fed. So they're taking it slow for now because they're still more willing to support growth. And there's not that much inflation pressure that's materializing across Asia compared to, say, the US or Europe. So I think it's a very nuanced view. And in terms of strategy, it is also quite mixed, right? Even if there's a spread within the DM space, right? If you're looking for a curve flattening across the US, that's the same view we had since the middle of the year. We expect that to play out for the next 4 to 8 quarters. We expect inflation fears to actually go off, right? So we have to split inflation into quite a few parts, right? The reopening and this supply logjam, I think it will fade. So I think we'll pass this round of peak inflation fears. Nobody really expects the US to sustain inflation rates of 5-6% for many, many months. Right? It's got to go down. Right? So in terms of strategy, we are in the flattening camp for the US. We think that JGBs should still do very well because the BOJ is still very, very dovish. We think that inflation worries will start to cool off. In fact, they've already started cooling off. Right? For the EM side, I think it's more nuanced. It becomes more of a, will we get a better growth inflation mix in 2022 compared to what we saw this year, where this vaccine inequity and the ability to deal with the virus caused a lot of EMs, including in Asia, to not be able to sustain the same kind of economic bounce that we saw in DM. So if indeed we get a better growth inflation mix, not just in the DM, but across the whole world, then we could be in for a much more hopeful 2022.
Eugene, what about CGBs, the China government bonds? What's your view?
Yeah, CGBs is something that we really like. We really liked it since the start of the year because it is one of the earliest major central banks to normalize policy because they have a focus on making sure there's no excessive speculation and they don't really believe in QE. So when any kind of response when they do tends to be targeted, especially when there is no big crisis. So in fact, they normalized policy as early as the middle of last year, and which means that the 10-year CGB yields were already above 3% by then, and it was exceedingly attractive from a long-only perspective because nowhere else would you get a market of this size that offered that kind of yield cushion. Whereas if you had invested in US Treasuries or bonds or JGBs, you probably will not get much returns, if any, if you invested over the past 4-6 quarters or so. And it has very little correlation with the rest of the G10, right? So it's a very good diversification an asset, right?
And the currency also helped. So yes, from a foreign total return perspective.
Yes, from a total return perspective, it is extremely, extremely attractive. Yeah.
Right. There's a question for you from one of our viewers. The question is, how were your calls in 2021, Eugene, and how did they play out?
Yeah, so 2021 is, in my view, a lot more challenging for people who look at macro. It's not like last year where the teams are more consistent and the policy response and the market response are more aligned. Right, this year I can identify two shocks, right? So we were right in calling for inflation and normalization at the start of the year. But when the Delta variant hit, the severity of it, and then the realization that vaccines are not as strong, not as potent versus that variant, led to yields falling quite a fair amount towards the third quarter. Right, and then subsequently we caught the bounce up because we said, hey, we were gonna overcome it. So that went up. And then over the past 2 weeks, again, the Omicron variant hit, and then there was again a correction lower in yields. So I would say that it's a very fast shifting market this year, and some teams don't even last beyond a year. So we did stick to a few core views that we've held, and one is that we have to get into a normalization, and that has been playing out. And we have also said that the curve will continue to flatten after the June's FOMC, and we kept to the view. Right, clearly it's flattened a lot faster than what we thought was possible, but that view, we are keeping to it still flattening.
Before you go, one quick question on the high yielders of Asia. Indonesia and India are two bond markets that global investors love to buy and hold. Should they keep on holding?
I think we're rather neutral on it right now, because I think the issue is how much more Fed tightening has got to be digested first. Mm. I think based on the charts that you showed, they're in a much stronger position now compared to 2013, and that is true. But I do think that certain US core rates are still a little bit too low. So for example, 10-year yields were trading above 1.6% just 2 weeks ago, right? And then just because of this Omicron shock, there's some insurance that people want to buy, right? So if it turns out that Omicron is not as severe, that we could see further unwinding that could put a bit more pressure on the higher yielders. So I'm rather neutral now. I'll be waiting to see when there will be better opportunities
All
to
right.
go along.
So some caution. All right.
Yeah.
Eugene, thank you very much. Happy New Year to you.
Thank you. Happy New Year.
All right. So that was Eugene Leow on rate strategy. We will now move on to currencies. For that, we have with us senior currency strategist Philip Wee. Philip, welcome to the live stream.
Good to be here, Timer.
Great to have you. Lots of questions on US dollar and JPY and all that stuff. So why don't you take it away, walk us through your main themes for next year.
Okay, before I talk about next year, let me quickly recap this year. I think at this point, if you ask anyone, why did the dollar come up, right? So most people will tell you it's the Fed, but that's only after the fact. Okay, I think for us at the start of the year, firstly, I think we foresaw the bottoming of the dollar. And that was a lot to do with the blue wave, Biden stimulus. So we saw US potentially becoming stronger than usual. So, and of course, the bond yield spiked up. You know, but that really didn't hold up the dollar. You know, so what really changed was the Fed stance. So ever since US inflation crossed 5% in May, so the Fed shifted to hawkish. And now we have the Powell's pivot. So this was really the driver for the dollar's upturn in the second half of this year. So that's something that I want to establish, because that will be quite instrumental in how we view right. the next 2 years.
Very good. Okay, so these are your main themes that I have on the
correct.
Screen now, yes.
So so next year, we do expect the dollar to continue extending the uptrend. The key thing is that we have penciled in two Fed hikes in the fourth quarter. Basically, I'm betting on your call. And I've learned one thing, and that is that the dollar went up despite the bond yields coming off. And that's where the Fed stance is very important. So if we do get Fed hikes, but they must be hawkish. But once Fed hikes are dovish, then the dollar would peak, just like what we saw in 2017. And of course, let's say by end of next year, US inflation probably would have peaked and maybe it's coming off, you know, but it remains to be seen if it will drop below 2%. But nonetheless, you know, the monthly numbers will be, you know, well off from the peak. So then I was, you know, start thinking about dovish hikes, and I think by then China may be more constructive, you know, and US, you know, we might not get another blue wave at the midterm elections, and that could sort of remove some of the shine from the policy from the Biden administration for the second term. So I think so that's how I'm picturing the landscape, you know, 1 to 2 years from now.
Let me ask you one question. The 4 years of trade years under Trump and this last 1 year with the pandemic and the stimulus and all that, whenever US tension goes up, is that good for the dollar against the RMB, or RMB has been standing up pretty well despite the tension?
Okay, my answer to that will be, you know, shocks, uncertainties. So most of the time when the trade war first came out and China started depreciating the renminbi, so most of us, you know, this is uncharted territory, so naturally we'll just follow the dollar China up. So I think it's the same with COVID. I mean, we had the same shock, but now with Omicron, you know, but we already, like what Eugene has mentioned, 2 years experience with it. I think from the central bank's point at this, you know, at this juncture, you know, we are facing supply constraints. You know, companies, I don't think, will make the same mistake, or rather think they won't be making the same mistake, you know, like last year at the outbreak. You know, I'll cut back production, I'll cut back hiring. You know, so this time, you know, I think it will continue. So in that sense, I believe that the central banks on the whole, you know, yes, we have seen some negative GDP numbers, but overall full-year growth is still above trend. You know, so I think for them is, we need to, that's why I guess Powell remove transitory. All central banks, I believe, will start joining. So this presents a challenge to the dollar's uptrend. Last year, you know, or this year, the dollar has already taken back 50% of what it lost in the previous year. So just like stock market, we had a nice V-shape. Yes, this year, US stock markets are still posting record highs, you know, but the gradient is much flatter. So I do think the dollar will probably, you know, do the same kind of square root formation.
Right.
But a lot to do with the fact that inflation has also picked up to above trend in Europe, UK, and other, you know, central banks as well. And they will need to address, you know, and present a credible normalization plan. So this is where I believe that there'll be more rotation plays. You know.
Okay, so on that rotation, I want to go back to the RMB question one more time. Mm-hmm. So the dollar strength story is a secular story, but not against the RMB. RMB actually appreciated against the dollar this year. So when you talk about this 22-23 rotation where the dollar will sort of peak, and I see the third thing, you've got a bear case for US dollar in 2023. Mm-hmm. So by inversion, does that mean the RMB will remain strong, or that's a whole different story?
I believe RMB is always a laggard. You know, so it's the one call that, you know, has not materialized for me. I feel like it's a bit like 2019, you know, when I was calling for a dollar sing to be above 140. It never came, you know, until February 2020, you know, and it just collapsed, you know, or, you know, dollar sing shot at 140 in February, just in a few, in a week. So I think RMB will probably play catch up. I believe that it's also correlated with the dollar index. So based on where the index is, it should be above 650. You know, I think closer to 660, 670. That's the forecast I have for third quarter of next year.
So you don't expect this whole narrative of China economic slowdown, the triple R cuts by PBOC as we saw yesterday, and I think our China team is expecting another 50 basis points of triple R cut in the first quarter of next year. You don't think this narrative play into a major weakening of RMB?
I do think it will contribute.
Okay.
And I do think PBOC is monitoring the RMB, not against the dollar, but against the basket. It's at the 60-year high.
Exactly.
So, you know, when we see that kind of narrative, I mean, we've heard it in the ECB, you know, when I think Euro NER was at record high, even though Euro is, you know, it's low against the dollar. But, you know, the
ECB, on a nominal effective basis, they were
so they keep pushing that story where US is stronger, Eurozone is not that strong. So on a relative basis, I think we may see some kind of story in that form, you know, playing out right now.
Very good. Now, you've already talked a little bit about your calls earlier. So the first question that mm-hmm. was coming from our listeners for you, mm-hmm. I'm repeating that. I had already mentioned that in the context mm-hmm. of Eugene. How were your calls in 2021, and did they play out?
I would say that depending on which currency that you're looking at, for the main dollar, for the euro, it exceeded our expectations. Quite happy that it did. And I think some of the other calls, which we were quite happy, was that Indonesian rupiah, Indian rupee, you know, we took the view that they would be resilient to the Fed taper, and that played up pretty well.
Particularly the rupee has been very strong, yeah.
Yes. So, and, so for Singapore dollar, we were looking for it to return to the 2018-19. And even though, you know, we were the only one who called the MAS policy correct, you know, in terms of returning to appreciation policy, but we also, you know, felt that the dollar sing would follow the dollar basket up. And indeed, you know, it's right now at 137. So I would say that on the whole, this has been quite a good year.
Very good. Okay, but could next year be a big crash? So the next question is, do you think a market correction is coming?
Well, I'm really keeping my fingers crossed. And I have my fair share of, you know, the ups and downs. So I'm hoping that this time around, I've read the tea leaves correctly, and I'm putting a lot of faith, you know, in not so much on the interest rate level itself, but really the Fed policy stance, you know, and of course on the other central banks playing catch up. So I think it's going to be ongoing. So if I'm correct, then you know the gradual stance will play out.
Yeah. So normalization without a tantrum.
I hope not.
Yeah. Very good. We'll keep that in mind, Philip. Thank you very much, and Happy New Year to you.
Happy New Year to you.
Thank you. Yeah. All right, so we have done rates. We have done currencies. We will now talk about credit, which was a major issue, or should have been a very big issue. And as our colleague Chang Wei Liang has shown already through his analysis, it actually didn't turn out to be a very big issue. But does he have that confidence going into 2022? So that's where, Wei Liang, you come in. Tell us about your major themes for the coming year on the credit space.
So for 2022, we are a bit more optimistic about the outlook. We think that the reopening that we're seeing across the world will support credit, particularly in the case of the US. So in the US, we have seen defaults coming at a very multi-year low of just under $6 billion for this year. So this is a very sharp turnaround of what we saw in 2020 when the US energy sector recorded a very high number of defaults. If you look across, the rating agencies have been upgrading U.S. corporates at a very rapid clip. The number of upgrades far outpaced the number of downgrades in the U.S. corporate space. So all things taken into consideration, we think that credit quality is likely to be strong, not just in U.S., but also for emerging Asia as well. But at the same time, we will caution that valuations do look a bit expensive because credit spreads, they are still fairly near record lows. They have widened a little bit since the Fed announced taper, but we think that with further Fed normalization, there's always a risk that we could see a bit more uptick in credit spreads. So how will we position for this? We would prefer to be selectively positioned. We like the US banks subordinated there because we think the banking sector is likely to see profitability pick up as the Fed hike interest rates. So that will provide positive tailwinds for the US banking credit. For the rest of Asia, I think the picture is rather mixed if you just look at China. So China, there have been a lot of headlines coming through because of what's happening in the real estate sector. But it's really a case of real estate being a very special case. Idiosyncratic risk is quite prevalent in this sector. But the rest of China credit has actually done fairly well this year. So why is the real estate sector under so much pressure? So part of the reason is due to the fact that liquidity stress has become more prevalent across Chinese real estate developers, and a lot of this is policy-induced, actually. So it might sound a little bit of a conflict. Why would policymakers want to create instability in the real estate sector? But actually, the policymakers are very concerned about the high degree of leverage in some of these economies. So we think that that's likely going to be a, 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 a an area of attention for credit markets still going into next year?
Now, when I think about a country's real estate market, or in the context, say, of the 2007-2008 crisis, at that time, the real estate market collapsed, the banks collapsed, because the banks are on the other side of, you know, extending mortgages and financing construction projects and so on. Why would that not be the case in China? Why shouldn't I be bearish Chinese banks if I'm not particularly optimistic about Chinese construction sector?
So we think there's a big difference between what's going on in China and what's happened in the US during the last subprime crisis. So the main reason is because the Chinese banks, they were already well regulated. So under regulations, they were not allowed to extend too much loans to real estate developers. So a lot of that has that's translated to a bit of a tightening in terms of credit that's available to real estate developers. But at the same time, they're shielded banks, I think, to some extent. Assuming there's no concentration risk, one or two defaults along the way are not likely to be a significant concern for Chinese banks. The other part of the story is that a lot of these loans, they're collateralized by land holdings, property, etc. So that means that a lot of these losses could be mitigated to some extent because the banks could take over control of the collateral, and that will shield them a little bit in terms of the possible losses. So the interesting thing is our banking equity analysts have done some scenario modeling, assuming 10% of developer loans were to go bad and assuming a 30% haircut on real estate collateral. And the impact on banking sector NPLs is relatively small, under 30 basis points. The impact on banking sector's capital adequacy ratios are also very small, under 25 basis points. So we don't think the banks are too worried. We don't see a scenario where, you know, capital levels will fall to dangerously low levels and that will impair credit creation in whole of our Chinese economy.
Very interesting. Now, so you heard from Eugene earlier that we're looking at flatter curves as the monetary policy tightening cycle matures. You also heard from Philip that, you know, the dollar may weaken down the road, but not now. So coming into 2022, strong dollar, higher short-term rates on the US dollar space, is that a constructive scenario for dollar credit issuers in Asia?
So generally, we observe that when the dollar is strengthening, credit spreads tend to widen in Asia. But we say that there are a few factors that we're considering at this point. So one, of course, if dollar liquidity is to tighten too substantially, because if the Fed was to accelerate taper, for instance, or to raise rates really quickly, then that could be very significant headwinds for Asian credit. But at the same time, consider the fact that most of Asia will be entering into a reopening phase of the economy. Vaccination rates are also rising in some of the more vulnerable economies like India and Indonesia. So we are hopeful that we are not going to see very severe disruptions to these economies in 2022. What's more likely happens is that we could see some localized lockdowns, but it's not going to significantly dent growth in these economies. And therefore, that should provide some degree of buffers for credit in this region. But of course, there will be some volatility. And as we have seen with Omicron, there could be twists and turns along the way. But our bias is that with an improving economy, and also on top of the fact that with commodity prices being so strong, that will be provide very substantive support for certain selected Asian credit, including some of the Indonesian commodity producers.
Because of a higher energy and
because
commodity
of
price
higher, outlook. Yes.
Very good. So I think that green bullets that I had over there, the constructive scenario earlier, I think you sort of subscribe to that. So I'm pleased to hear that. Let's hope that, you know, your credit view and my green bullets, you know, all converge nicely next year.
Fingers crossed.
Well, Young, you not only cover credit, but you wear a different hat. We write every quarter a digital asset primer. And in this year, you have at least two other primers. You know, you are a co-author. So I thought that one of these questions that came in, probably the toughest question of all, I'll throw it to you. And that's the question right there. What is the crypto outlook for 2022, Will Young?
Right. So this is definitely one of the most difficult questions to answer, right? So, but let's break it down into what the market dynamics
take your time.
The driving cryptocurrencies. So one thing that we have observed is that people tend to think of cryptocurrencies as a hedge against inflation. So there is a positive correlation between cryptocurrency prices as well as inflation breakevens. When inflation breakevens are higher, cryptocurrencies have gone up. So the recent crash in cryptocurrency markets just over the weekend, that's not entirely surprising because it comes at the back of a fading inflation breakevens. The Fed has turned more hawkish. We have known that for sure. Breakevens are coming lower. So that has created some degree of headwinds for cryptocurrencies.
So stop right there. I just want to expand on that point because that's a very interesting one. So you have been analyzing this cross-correlation over time through the course of this year and the past years. And your view is that there is decent econometric evidence to suggest that crypto is being seen as a bit of a hedge against inflation.
So we do think that there's a case to be made, but of course, is it the best possible tool to hedge against inflation? We think that there's a lot of nuance to be explained on, because crypto is very volatile. So even if it hedges inflation very well in the long run, there's always a risk that you're going to see volatility right. impair returns to the extent that it doesn't actually hedge against inflation to the point that you might be actually be too swayed by volatility in cryptocurrency markets. So that's one thing. The other thing to note is that cryptocurrencies are also driven by another dynamic. So it has positive correlation with risky assets. It's not really a safe haven. So if, for instance, we see equities prices coming under pressure, then that's going to imply that, you know, is cryptocurrencies are not as good as inflation hedge as what we think that it should be. So these are the factors that we're looking at in terms of trying to form an outlook. But from the longer range perspective, then I think cryptocurrencies will, how the price will evolve will depend on the applications that are being that are coming through in the cryptocurrency space. So I'm sure everyone knows what's happening in the metaverse. We have Decentraland tokens that allow people to participate in this metaverse games. So we also have other interesting applications that are being developed for Ethereum in terms of not just NFTs, but you know, possibly other new applications. So from that perspective, I would say the ecosystem outlook is still relatively strong. People are still trying to experiment, find new ways and new use cases for cryptocurrency. So that's something that we take comfort in.
And on the regulatory space, we saw some serious pushback this year. I mean, the Chinese have been tough on mining for a couple of years now, but also in terms of usage, they've taken stronger measures. India is sort of, you know, oscillating between outright ban and heavy regulation. But at the same time, we're seeing some countries in Latin America embracing crypto. So net-net, was 2021 a good year for crypto usage or a bad year for crypto usage?
I think from the perspective of China banning crypto possession as well as transactions is probably not as good a year because we know that China is one of the top two economies in the world. If Chinese users are not going to be so involved in the cryptocurrency ecosystem, then that's probably a net detraction. But at the same time, we see cryptos holding up quite well even after news of the ban broke. So it appears to be a case that fundamental sentiment has not been too dented, even though regulations are coming through, not just in China, but also in India, where they're studying whether or not they could potentially ban cryptocurrency trading. So I would expect regulatory headwinds to continue, but not completely derail how cryptocurrencies will evolve in the coming year.
So take the macro discussion that we've had so far today. You know, I talked about growth sort of normalizing in the DM world in 2022. But in EM, reopening trade. Then you heard from Eugene talking about flatter curves and some degree of, you know, hawkishness coming from the Fed, on the back of which Philip is still bullish the dollar. So this sort of a macro environment helps risk-taking behavior, whether it's on equities or cryptos, or does it call for a calmer, less exuberant market in 2022?
I think the Fed is still pretty much the global central banker that we should pay attention to. So we know if they're withdrawing liquidity, even if the growth outlook is improving, then that's going to some extent, dent appetite for risky assets. So from that point of view, even if growth is stronger, but if rates were to rise, as we have been calling for rate hikes for 2022, or if the amount of dollar liquidity turns less flush, then that produces, I think, quite significant headwinds for risky asset behavior. So all else considered, I think we're going to see quite a mixed picture in terms of not just cryptos, but risky assets.
Right. You know, William, what's amazing is that we probably could have said more or less the same thing a year ago. 2021 was not supposed to be the year it turned out to be, where we had substantial gains on equities on top of substantial gains in 2020, but we had a very good year. And we also probably would have expected some degree of credit stress in China, much more so than it happened, or serious sovereign difficulties on the top of that debt buildup narrative. It didn't quite happen that way. Not that, you know, we succeeded against the pandemic, but it seems like we've succeeded pretty well against the economic and financial sector management. So 2023 could be one more year of the Fed put, where the Fed talks about hike, starts tapering and goes into hike, and then we completely melt down, and then we go back to dovish territory, which is not the greatest for moral hazard, not the greatest for debt dynamic, but great for financial markets. So we shall see how that all pans out. We have more or less run out of time. I'm going to end the discussion right here. Liang, thank you very much for your time. Happy New Year to you.
Happy New Year.
And let's keep tracking our calls and market analysis. To those of you watching and who have sent in your questions and have been watching us regularly through the course of the year, thank you very much. We appreciate your support tremendously. And we have a fantastic team of tech experts sitting just behind the camera. I tip my hat to them for pulling us this great show. And if you have noticed, compared to your previous viewings, this was a somewhat higher resolution. It's because we upgraded the broadcast to 720p today. So wish all of you a happy holidays. Stay safe, whether you're traveling or not. And as you know, the macro environment is fluid, full of interesting challenges. Therefore, you have to come and watch us every single month to stay on top of what's going on. So with that, I'm going to end this here as a Macro Insights live stream. Thank you very much. Have a great day.